dressers.
This is looking good, super.
Oh my gosh.
Alright, yeah. I apologize, we are running late and that's my fault, trying to get everybody situated. So, you're good, I think you're okay, I can see. We have daycare.
Daycare.
Karen is out there, she's watching them this week and next week, and we've got, a couple of different girls lined up, so hopefully we can, keep going.
We now officially have a payroll. We're paying daycare.
We are paying daycare, we are, and I haven't even okayed that yet, so I, it'll be, it is what it is, we'll make it work.
He's a little devil.
That's usually how I act, and I know they don't listen to this, so we're good. Alright, hey, announcements really quick, barbecue is next weekend, we met with the band yesterday, super excited, kilometer 81. Long story made much shorter because I'm running late. They got their name based off of Panama, is that right? No.
Paraguay.
Their family does missions in Paraguay at a leper hospital. It is a world renowned hospital. It's the largest in the world that heals lepers. And it meets at kilometer 81. So they named it kilometer 81.
81 kilometers from the capital city. There's a sign there that says that. So
he's helping me because my brain is very scattered this morning, so I apologize for that. And I thought, how fitting is it that they are serving the least of the least? And anyway, and so that's what we do. So I'm excited. I'm excited to have them. I think it'll be a good time. That kind of stuff. I need you guys here for those of you that are helping. That would be fabulous. That way we can make sure everything's set. We still have moths. They are everywhere. And we can kind of go from there. All right. So Forish on Saturday next week. I know Jesse and Tasia are going to help pull pork. Those are going to drive me crazy. Go for it. Kill it. Kill it. I just ordered it dead again.
My hero.
Yeah. Strike three. Strike four.
Strike five. Strike three. Keep talking. The battle is on, and I know it's because we're doing community outreach. This morning, one of my ovens stopped working again, so I know it'll be okay. We're gonna get through it. But pray a wall of protection around of Mary Mag this week. We had a whole new family come in yesterday. I've added 5 new counseling sessions to the schedule this week, which is amazing because that's why we're here. But the battle's on, and we're gonna win. All right, because Jesus wins.
Yes.
So I just want you to be aware that the tension and the stress is very much there for me. And so if you would please keep Mary Mag in your prayers as we go.
Jada.
I'm going. I'm down. Okay. All right. Other prayer requests that we need to pay attention to. Yes, to our daughter Jada is in jail. Now, everything I can tell, she went in last night. It's because it was a failure to appear. So she hasn't done anything new, which I think is a good thing. Jail is a good thing for her. It keeps her off the streets and that kind of stuff, but it also means that I have no idea what's going on, which always stresses me out just a bit. Seth, we haven't heard from him in a long time, so keep him in your prayers because I'm pretty sure he'll pop up this week because that's usually what happens in my world. And Sierra will be traveling to Kansas next Sunday for a couple weeks before they go to Okinawa. So we've got a lot of family stuff going on top of Mary Mag stuff. We need to pray for our Crossroads family. Crossroads Church has experienced yet another loss. The Missy Hoffman family. Brandon Hoffman passed away this week. He had colon cancer. Went in for surgery on his liver. I don't know all the details, but he never They have 4 or 5 kids living at home still. It's just a bad deal. So just please lift them up. That funeral, if you're interested, is Saturday morning at 11 a.m. is what I read this morning is the plan. So I don't know if I'm going to get there or not on Saturday, but if you're friends with that family, that's what's going on there. Your prayer requests.
I got a praise.
Yay! I could use a praise.
Obviously, the Nick Hayes has come back. It's a good thing just to have him back and
yeah, it's very good for Tom. Nice to do that.
Very, very good.
Did you move back?
Yeah, he moved back from Manhattan and so he's
yay, look at that. Good, I can take my sound system. Woohoo. Just kidding. What else you got for me?
I have a prayer request. We got a new boss. And it's already a struggle with her, and she hasn't even started yet. She starts Monday. But, like, she's already throwing a bunch of stuff at us that we're not used to, and it's causing some...
Very much a micromanager.
Yes, and it's causing some friction at work, and just a bunch of extra stress that we're not used to, and we're used to a lot of stress, but maybe just... prayers that, I don't know, that everything can end up being a smooth run.
Bo and Toyla aren't here. Toyla's sister, I think they're coming, I don't know that for sure, because I know that Toyla's sister is having surgery this week, and I know that last night they ran food to Emporia to meet halfway, so that her sister would have food for the week, because that is what Toyla does. So, keep Toyla's sister. I don't know which one. I don't know her name. I just know that Toyla said her sister was having surgery this coming week. Anything else?
Yeah, just pray for like addiction and addicts and stuff. I've seen like a lot of people personally I know struggling and battling with addiction recently, so just prayers for God to intervene how he does with that.
I'm going to put Young Life on here because I think that the Fleemans are gearing up for summer camps and all kinds of stuff there, and they are running around with their heads cut off also. It's a great organization that they run downtown that works with the youth of our community, and so I'm going to put Young Life on there. I think we need to remember them as well. Anything else?
Mothers and daughters that sometimes see things differently. And
you think?
Need to remember that they love each other.
Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for today, Lord. I thank you that the sun is up. I thank you that we've had rain. Lord, I thank you that... we are blessed with this place, Lord, that I can see you moving. I can see the people coming in the doors. Lord, I am humbled to watch as you move. As I saw it yesterday, I'm never surprised you move, but I'm always surprised at how you connect the people together and to do your work and to do your will. And Lord, I just praise you for that. I praise you for it every moment as we worship here today, Lord. And we come together, Lord. We've got a lot going on here at Mary Mag this coming week. We've got lots of different groups meeting and counseling and all of that stuff. Lord, I just pray your presence be upon all of it and all of the hearts of those that are working and coming through our doors. Lord, we pray for our barbecue next week, Lord. We pray that it is a wonderful outreach to our community, that we can serve them, that those that come feel at home and enjoy themselves, and that... it helps us build your ministry, Lord. I pray that upon our barbecue. Lord, I pray for our Crossroads family, Lord. I love those people over there, and my heart hurts for them. They've gone through so much lately. Lord, I just pray that their service today, they are able to praise your name in the midst of their sorrow. And Lord, I pray for Missy and her family, and as she's trying to grieve the loss of her husband, but also to help her kids grieve the loss of their dad. So Lord, I just pray blessings on that family and peace. And Lord, I pray that she is surrounded by people to help her and hold her up as she walks this next journey of her life. Lord, I lift up Jada. Lord, I pray that she learns a lesson, Lord, where she's at, Lord, and that she comes out on the other side of this a better person, Lord. I always pray, Lord, that she seeks after you, Lord, and that her addiction becomes you and not the drugs that she so desires. Lord, we pray for Sierra and their family. Their house is packed. Lord, we just pray for an easy move, Lord. There's a lot of emotion there, so I just pray blessings over them. Lord, we thank you that Nick is back in town. Lord, we are thankful he is back with us. Lord, we're just thankful for Nick. Lord, we pray for April and her work situation and the new boss, and it's always hard for change. Lord, we pray that it goes smooth and things work themselves out there. Lord, we pray for Toyla and her sister. Lord, we pray that the surgery goes well and that there's complete healing there. Lord, we pray for the addicts that are struggling, Lord. It seems to just be continuous. Lord, Lord, we just pray that you continue to send people their direction, that guide them towards you. Lord, we lift up Young Life as they get ready for camps and all of the summer stuff. Lord, what a wonderful, wonderful ministry you have put in downtown Hutchinson. Lord, I pray for the kids, and I pray for the leaders. Lord, I just pray that you are moving in each and every one of their lives. Lord, we pray for our families. Family is hard. It just is. And so, Lord, I just pray that you bless our families. Lord, I thank you for today. I thank you that we are here, that we can worship and praise your name. Amen. Greet somebody quickly.
Hi, Grandma Cheryl.
Because I'm
I'm saving my heart and my knowledge.
Today's Old Testament reading is Deuteronomy 26, 20 through 8, and 32. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commands of the Lord and your God that I am giving you today. The curse, if you disobey the commands of the Lord your God and turn from the way that I command you today by following other gods which you have not known. Be sure that you obey all the decrees and laws that I am setting before you today. In our New Testament reading is Matthew 7, 21 through 27. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? Then I tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rocks. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew, beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
Good, good Father, perfect in all of your ways. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Even when life is tough, do you agree with that?
Yes.
Even when our friends die on surgery tables, do you agree with that? We can't make God the author of death. He's not. He's not. He's the author of life. The devil still has power in this world until the second coming. And awful stuff is going to happen. Don't attribute the crap to God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Okay, I'm warning you. It's 9:30 right now. This may be a while. This may be a while. This subject's been bouncing around in my head. There's a lot of moving parts to it. And so I want to wrap up Pentecost from last week. I watched the video and listened to you guys' testimonies. Shirley, the fact that in your spirit you're worried about your assurance proves that you have insurance. Okay? I worry about mine. Bo and I have a joke together. We love learning about St. Peter because St. Peter was an idiot.
Yeah,
but we think if St. Peter can not only lead the church, but he can get in, there's hope for us. Okay? So the fact that there are sin in our life and things that we trip over and trip over and trip over continually, Stephen, you and I have talked oftentimes. I keep falling over the same thing. It's because we're human. And it's because the devil still has power until the second coming. All right? So, the fact that you're worried about it. Man, I love Jesus, but I just don't think. The fact that you're worried about it shows that your spirit is in the right place. It shows that your heart is in the right place. So, if you're looking, hold on to that because your instincts are correct. Does that make sense? I would like to talk about all of the rest of them. Tasia, I loved your, it was great. I'm on the clock. Pentecost, last week. Now, Holy Spirit comes, falls on the church is born. So we like to refer to Pentecost as the birthday of the church. Okay, this is when the church was born. Now, the very next week, this week, our fathers of the faith decided that we should know, go ahead and turn on the lights there, Bruce. Our fathers should know that this is Holy Trinity Sunday. Okay, so birthday of the church, very next week, Holy Trinity. Should we assume there's some importance to understanding the Trinity if it's like the week after birthday of the church? Okay, so let's not lose the fact that that is somewhat importance. Now, I have to preach this message or talk through this journey that I've been on for a long time with some context. Is Bruce coming back? Because he can't miss the context.
Yeah, he got to
get a
drink.
Let's go, Bruce! So the context is actually a video that I'm going to show. Don't hold it against me. Go ahead and kill the lights again. And Annette, show the video here. Hey, Bruce, kill these lights right here.
Tell me why most alligators are abnormal in grass.
I know the answer.
Anybody? Anyone? Yes, please.
Mama said that alligators are ornery because they got all them teeth but no toothbrush.
Your mama said alligators are ornery because they got all them teeth and no toothbrush. Wow. Anybody else? Yes, please.
Alligators are aggressive because of an enlarged medulla oblongata. It's the septum of the brain which controls aggressive behavior.
That is correct. The medulla oblongata.
Mama said.
The medulla oblongata is where anger, jealousy, and aggression come from. Now, is there anybody here who can tell me where happiness comes from? Anyone? All right. Let's hear what Mama has to say on the subject.
Mama say that happiness is from magic rays of sunshine that come down when you're feeling blue.
Well, folks, Mama's wrong again.
No, Colonel Sanders, you're wrong. Mama's right.
So, if any of you think I'm going to hell for showing the water boy in church, you're allowed to raise your hand. What I want you to get is that... she raised her hand, yeah, my wife. Is that the water boy was taught folklore. He was taught folklore by his mom, and he didn't know any better. That's what he grew up learning. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So... I just want to read a quick definition of what folklore is. Folklore is our cultural DNA. All right, DNA is the thing that makes us American, makes us Kansas, makes us whatever, right? It's our cultural DNA. It includes art, stories, knowledge, and the practices, how we live. All right, the practices of a people. Now, while folklore can be bound up in memory and history, it is also tied to the vibrant living traditions and the creative expressions of our day. So what this means is that the folklore that Central Kansas would be practicing is different than what is practiced in Texas, mm-hmm. or in Alabama, or in Rhode Island, or does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. What did we used to say? There's nothing in California but fruits and nuts. Okay, that's because we're talking about their folklore, how they live, what they practice, what they deem to be important. Now, here's the problem, is you think you're normal because you grew up with what Mama said. Bobby Boucher, or the water boy, didn't know he was wrong because this is how he grew up. Do you understand the context? Okay, so I want you to hold on to that. And then I want to tell you this. In recent years, I've heard less and less about the Trinity, about the triune nature of God, about the Godhead. I've heard less and less and less of that. And what I've heard more and more of is all you need is Jesus. That's what I hear the most of. All you need is Jesus. So the question I start rolling around in my bread, in my head, and really started pinging, the ping pong balls were bouncing like crazy this week, was, okay, is, which one is the folklore? Is it the Trinity? Is it the triune nature of God? That's a cultural thing? Or is it that all we need is Jesus? And so I just want to talk about that today with you and let you kind of feel out these steps that I'm walking. Is that all right? Now, it's okay for you at this point to go, what in the world are we doing here? So, we have to, the reason why I showed the video is we have to understand we're all Him. We're all Him. In that how you were raised, where you were raised, the race that you're raised in, all of those things affect what you think. And they not only affect what you think, they affect what you think is normal. And so it's really hard to step outside of what you think is normal because outside of normal feels what? Abnormal. Right? Okay, so if you trust me, I want to take you on this little bit of a journey, but I got one more definition. Okay, folk religion. All right, folk religion is difficult to define for sure for most scholars. But most scholars agree that it, meaning folk religion, is distinct from the traditional belief and practice of organized religion, sometimes also termed popular belief. It consists of ethnic, regional, racial, religious customs under the umbrella of organized religion, but outside official doctrines and/or practices. This is not to say that those who practice quote-unquote folk religion are not also members of a mainline organized religion, but they are incorporating additional beliefs, rituals, practices that are not part of the official doctrine and or practice. Are you with me so far? Okay. In many ways, this is a creative process among the members, adding traditional or cultural beliefs, local customs, elements of folk healing, folk magic, superstition. It is religion as it is lived. It's the religion of our everyday life. John, you and I have talked a lot, you know, and Nick, I think you were in on some of these conversations way back when we were at Father's house doing the deacon training stuff. And I said, I've always wondered that if like Paul or Peter or some of the early leaders of the church, if they came to our church now in this day and age, if they had like a time machine, would they recognize us as Christian? It's a question I've asked myself. Would they recognize us as Christian, or would they recognize us as something else? It's been a journey I've been on for a long time. What did our fathers of the faith believe? Why did they believe it? How did they practice it? How did all of this happen?
How did we get to a place where there's 147,000 different denominations? How did we get here? I don't care if you're Baptist or Catholic or Methodist or whatever you are. I don't care where you came from. But you can't read that and not see you in there. That's us. We're the wire boy. Why? Because Mama said, or my pastor said, or my Sunday school teacher said, or somebody said, and you went, that's what I believe. But you never looked it up. You never researched it. You never asked why. It doesn't make you bad. It just makes you human. Are we okay so far?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I want to share a text message with you that I got from a pastor this week. Okay, out of the blue, he sends this to me. He says, here's what all my years of church planting and ministry has confirmed in me. The gospel is a call to repentance of sin and faith in Jesus Christ, not a call to cheap grace and easy believism. The American church, and he's using that as a term, the quote-unquote American church, has perverted the message of the gospel to Jesus loves you, come live a better life, instead of come and die. Let me read through that last part again. The American church has perverted the message of the gospel. What has it perverted it to? This is what he thinks it's perverted it to. Jesus loves you, come live a better life, instead of come and die. So when we talk about surrender, we're talking about come and die. The New Testament readings that John read this morning are the one in Matthew 7 is the scariest passage in the book. Lord, did I not prophesy in your name? And he says, depart from me, I never knew you. I respond with, I agree. The how or why is the interesting question. I have a theory that I'm working out in front of you. I have a theory on this that has been bouncing around in my head for some time. I'm still trying to formulate it all, but I think it has to do with the, quote, American church emphasis on Jesus while ignoring the Godhead. We zero in on forgiveness, but we ignore the judgment, the kingdom to come, and this influence of the Spirit that through our obedience to the influence of the Spirit grafts us into the family of God. The word I'm feeling is folk religion. It's a mixture of truth that allows for a twisting of ancient traditions that enable us to adapt our faith for the culture of the moment. Focusing on forgiveness allows us to live culturally, knowing we're forgiven. But our sacred scriptures, our sacred traditions, and our creeds don't allow God's family to be members of a secular culture. Only members of God's family. That's good. I don't need to read his response, and there was quite a few back and forth there. But how does that grab you?
I've been there years ago.
What's that?
I said I thought that years. No.
What I don't want you. What I don't want you to think is that I'm saying that we don't need Jesus. Okay, that's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is that Jesus is a member of the Godhead. And that if we remove Jesus from the Godhead, then it's folk. It's not what was handed to us. Does that make sense? My my bishop, Quentin, used to say this all the time. He used to say, faith is not something we can make up. It's something that's been handed down to us. And I don't know that I understood the weight of that the first time I heard it, but the longer I walk, the more I understand the weight of it. Because the journey becomes what was handed to me. It isn't a disagreement with the statement. It's a what, okay, what was handed? Because everybody's handed something. So how do I know that's junk, that's good? Becomes that kind of question.
See, I think with this, what you're talking about, a lot of it is because of the come-as-you-are culture.
Yeah, so come-as-you-are is part of the Christian message. It is, right? But it doesn't mean stay-as-you-are. It means grow in your faith. Grow in your faith. And grow in your faith doesn't... Okay, I'm not going to go there. Nah, I was going to try to be funny. I don't want to be funny. I want to stay. Can we go to the book now? Can we? Let's open the book. Let's go to John 4. Let's go to John 4. John 4. Verses 23 and 24. I got a long way to go. The clock is ticking. John 4, 23 and 24. You guys there?
Yeah,
23 and 24, John 4, okay. Words in red, that means what?
Jesus.
Jesus is speaking. He says, an hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people, the Father seeks to be his worshipers. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Now, I want you to think about this in a Trinitarian way, okay? So, spirit and truth. An hour is coming. True worshipers. Do you want, do I want, do we want to be true worshipers of the Father?
Yeah.
Of course, right? It's like, it's a redundant question. Of course we do. How do we do that? In spirit and truth. Now, it's not only a description of the attributes of the worshiper, but it's also a description of the Trinity.
Yes.
You see that? Spirit and truth. So go to John 14:6. 14:6. Jesus says in John 14:6, and you guys all know this one, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Now, when we say, all you need is Jesus, the Trinitarian way of understanding that is, all we need is Jesus to get to the Father. You don't stop at Jesus. Does that make sense? Okay. I am the way, the truth, the life. I am the way. Jesus is the direction. How do we get to the Father? Through Jesus. Why? Because he's the way. He's the direction. He's Google Maps for spirituality. All right? I am the truth. Jesus is the essence of our seeking. Why are you seeking that out, Bruce? Because it's true. I'm seeking truth. Jesus is saying, the truth that you seek is me. Why? Because the truth takes you to the Father. And he says he's the life. You ever heard somebody say, hey, don't compare yourself to other Christians. Don't compare yourself to other Christians. Compare yourself to Jesus. Why? Because he's the life. He's what it should look like. How do we serve God the Father? The way Jesus did. That's why he's Jesus. So he's the way. He's the direction. He's the truth. He's the essence. He's the heart of it. And he's the life. He's the example of what it should look like. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Everybody with me? All right. Stay in John 14. Let's go to verses 16 and 17. Jesus says, verse 16, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him, but you know him because he lives with you and will be in you. Who is Jesus talking about?
The Holy Spirit.
Okay, what does verses 16 and 17, what does verse 16? I will ask the Father, he will give you another helper. What does that say about Jesus? Okay.
If it doesn't come from Jesus, it comes from God.
Okay.
And he's a third of the...
Yes, yes and yes, not what I'm looking for.
What was the question?
What does it say about Jesus? I'll ask the Father and he will give you another helper.
He's not the only helper.
Jesus is a helper.
Yeah, mine says, or I was, help, I like helper, but mine also says comforter, or like that too.
So Jesus is another helper, another advocate, another comforter. Why? To get you to the Father. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So Jesus is saying, hey, I got to go away, but we're going to send somebody else. He's going to do the same thing I've been doing, just do it a little in a different way. But if instead of just being me, it can be all over. Why? Because the Spirit can inhabit you and you and you and you and you. The circle of influence gets bigger. What's the point? To get to the Father. We good?
Amen.
Okay. I want to stay in the book a little bit. Let's go to Genesis 1. Genesis, go to the very beginning here. Genesis 1. Genesis 1. Shirley, get ready. You're going to want to write this down. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and there was evening, there was morning, one day. Everybody who wants to tear apart the creation account in Genesis starts there and says, he hasn't created the sun yet, so how can this be? And what I'm telling them is, shut up, understand what this is saying. All right? In the beginning, God created. God who? God the Father. Okay, so. God the Father equals source and cause. Sorry about the camera, honey. Source and cause. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. How do we define God the Father? He's the source and the cause of it. Everybody with me on that? Okay. He says in verse 3, God said, let there be light, and there was light. I'm going to short circuit a whole bunch of theology here. We know that Jesus is light. Right? So Jesus is the spoken word. God the Son equals the incarnate, which means living, right? Living word of what?
God.
Of the source and cause. God the Father is the source and cause. God the Son is the spoken word. He is the living word of the source and cause. We good?
Yeah.
Okay. What was hovering over the surface of the deep? The Spirit of God. Now, we know that God the Spirit equals the seal. You get sealed with oil, you're representing what happened in Genesis 1. The seal or binding of the spoken word of the source and cause. Okay, how does Father, Son, and Spirit work together? Well, the Father is the source. The Son is the spoken word of the source, and the Spirit is the one that binds that all together. He's the seal of it. Does that make sense? You get that in the first five verses of the book. Wait a minute, this doesn't read like a science book. It's not supposed to! It's supposed to explain to you how God works. Can we put the, I think I'm done over there, sorry. Thank you, Troy. Can we put the icon on the screen, please? So, now this is a icon of the Trinity, but it follows along an Old Testament story that's in Genesis 18, and I want to read that to you. It's in Genesis 18, starting in verse 1. Just eight verses here. Genesis 18, verse 1. Says, the Lord appeared to him meaning Abram, which would be Abraham, okay? So the Lord appeared to him by the oaks of Mamre, while he was sitting at the tent door in the heat of the day. When Abram lifted up his eyes and looked, behold, three men were standing opposite him. And when he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, my Lord, if now I have found favor in your sight, please do not pass your servant by. Please let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Is it fair to say that the Lord was three? Mm-hmm. I'm not taking poetic license with that, right? So when Abram looked up, he saw what he's describing as the Lord, and there was three men. And they met where? The oaks of Mamre, right? So in this, you see the tree behind them that's representing the oaks of Mamre. All right? Now, so they're seated. The three men, the Lord, is seated. Verse 4, it says, I'll bring a little water, be brought to wash your feet, rest yourselves under the tree. I will bring a piece of bread that you may refresh yourselves. After that, you may go on, since you have visited your servant. And they said, so do as you have said. So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah and said, quickly prepare three measures of fine flour, knead it, and make bread cakes. Abraham also ran to the herd and took a tender and choice calf and gave it to the servant, and he hurried to prepare it. What does that mean? Thank you. He's going to kill it, get ready to eat. Okay? It's what he's going to serve them. He took curds and milk and the calf which he had prepared and placed it before them, and he was standing by them under the tree as they ate. Now, this is a really old painting, so it's hard to see. But this looks like a calf's head inside the bowl, because it's referring to this story. All right? Now, there's all kinds of symbolism in this story, or in this painting. Of course there is, otherwise I wouldn't use it. But I want to explain some of that to you. God the Father, the source, the cause, is all the way to the left. God the Son, the incarnate living word of the source and the cause, is in the middle. God the Spirit, the seal, the binding of the spoken word, of the source and the cause, the Holy Spirit, is all the way to the right. Now, above the head of God the Father, can you see that there's a structure there? Okay, this is the house of God. It's not the house of Jesus. It's not the house of the Spirit. It's the house of God. All right? He's the source. He's the cause. Does that make sense? The oak of Mamre, which takes us to Genesis 18, is behind Jesus. Why else would there be a tree behind Jesus?
He's the tree of life.
He's the tree of life and the crucifixion. The cross was made out of wood. What's behind the Spirit? Hard to tell. It's a mountain. Why a mountain? Because the Holy Spirit is the thing that helps us ascend to spiritual height. The metaphor of climbing toward God. Mm-hmm. That making sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. The gold color represents kingship. It represents authority. What does blue represent?
Royalty.
Divinity. Now, if you look at Jesus, Jesus has divinity. Jesus has kingship and authority, sits down at the right hand of God the Father, right? Okay. But he also has this brown color because it represents humanity. It represents the earthy tones of life here because he was 100% man and 100% God, right? All right. And then you have the Holy Spirit, and Holy Spirit has the blue and the green. The blue represents divinity. The green represents... what's it represent in the garden?
Life.
Life.
Yeah.
Life. Making sense? Mm-hmm. Sarah, you okay? You with me? All right. Now, if you notice, God the Son and God the Spirit's heads are both inclined, bowed toward God the Father. Why? Because he's the source, he's the cause. Does that make sense? Okay, something else here that is very difficult to see. I'm going to use my moth swatter as a pointy stick here. So who's in the middle?
Jesus.
Okay, so follow the outline. Do you see the chalice?
Yeah.
What?
Do you see Jesus in the chalice?
Yeah.
Bing.
I need to wait.
Bing. We need to sit for a minute.
Yeah, I got some.
Okay.
Second, please.
Wow. One more thing here. Bruce, tell me when you're ready.
We're good.
Okay.
You should have a painter baller.
Okay, so Rublev, the Russian painter who did this long time ago, what he understood about the nature of the Trinity and the nature of the Trinity and how it relates to mankind is the reason why he included a mirror here. Because as I gaze at that, and I gaze at the Trinity, I see myself. Because you're invited into it. Does that make sense? So you have the source and the cause. You have God the Father. You have the incarnate Word of the Son. And you have the sealing, the binding of the Spirit. And we, the church, are invited into that because we're the hands and the feet. We have a role in the Trinitarian nature of God.
Amen.
There should have been a thunder strike or something right there, you know? I think we're all the water boy. I don't think we can escape that. I don't really think we can. We all have a mama in our life that says something. There's gonna be things that we hold to as if our very life depended on it. That's complete folklore. And I don't think that disqualifies us from God's grace. I don't. But I also think the journey that I have walked for the last 10 years of trying to discover what did our forefathers, who are our fathers of the faith, and why did they say and do the things that they said, and how does that translate to now, makes my spider sense twitchy. When it comes to things like, hey, all you need is Jesus. Yeah, but all you need is Jesus to get to the Father through the power of the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? And so today being Holy Trinity Sunday, I wanted to bring this to you with the understanding of, hey, we're going to wrestle with hard subjects, and we're going to try to tear them apart, and we're going to try to hit against some of these theologies, and some of it's going to be really uncomfortable. But that's working out our faith. That's working out our salvation with fear and trembling. It's one of the reasons why I say this isn't a church. This is a mission, because we got to work through this stuff. And this stuff will help us. It'll bring us to our knees. It'll surrender us even more. It'll make us say, Lord, the more I know nothing. And he'll say, then you're exactly in the spot that you need to be. So don't be afraid of being Bobby Boucher. Because we're all that. Okay? We're all that in some way. There's no way to end this. Just gonna pray. Lord in heaven, I love you. Lord, I'm thankful that you are source and cause and living word and the sealing and the binding of it all. Lord, I don't know how it works. I'm thankful for it. Lord, I pray that you would continue to do your work here. Not only within us, but without us. That we could, that from the outside, the people driving down the road recognize that whatever's going on over there, it's God's stuff. Lord, I pray for this upcoming weekend. Lord, I don't really care about the donations part of it. Lord, I care about the word of mouth part of it. Lord, I pray that the weather's perfect. Lord, I pray that the band is awesome. I pray that the food is great. And I pray that the people come. And they come in droves. And Lord, I pray that the word goes out. That the word goes out. Lord, I love you. Lord, I know these folks love you too. And all God's people said.
Amen.
As we go to our ministry time, think about who your mama is and what mama may have said that you're now starting to go, And let's make that a prayer. Let's make that a prayer.
So
God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. So when the triune nature of God comes together, Father, Son, and Spirit, Source, the word of, the binding of, you have a separation of light from darkness. John was asked to write a gospel account of Jesus because there was heresy beginning in the church that Jesus was not equal with God, that he was created by God, that he was son of God, but not equal with God. And John starts off this gospel by saying, in the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the incarnate living Word of the Source, the cause. And the Word was with God, was with the Source, and the Word was the Source. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In him, the incarnate Word of God, was life. And the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not come. Shivers, man. Shivers. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
What is it, Nick?
It is right.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Have you missed that for the last 9 months or so?
Every Sunday.
It is right to give him thanks and praise. It's our right, our duty, our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, Lord, we praise you. Joining our voices with the angels, the archangels, all of our ancestors, a whole company of heaven who forever and ever sing this hymn and proclaim his glory with these words, Holy,
holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
All praise and glory is yours, Lord. Our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy, you gave your only Son, Jesus, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. And he made there by his one offering of himself a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted his holy gospel and commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death and his sacrifice until he comes again. Why do you guys do communion every week? Because Jesus said in his holy gospel and commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until he comes again. Well, does that kind of make it old? Like, who cares? No! It's in the gospels! It's a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice. How can you get tired of talking about Jesus' death and sacrifice, right? So now, Lord, in your great goodness, we ask you to bless and to sanctify with your word and your Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine. Lord, take these normal, everyday, natural things and turn them into wild, crazy, supernatural things. Lord, may they become the blood and the body of Christ. May they nourish us with his grace. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said to his disciples, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body and it is broken for you." As often as you do this, do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And he said, "This is my blood. It's poured out for the forgiveness of sins. It's the blood of the new covenant." As often as you do this in remembrance of me. Takes away the importance. It's something we do to remember Jesus. Should we not remember Jesus as often as we can? Therefore, Lord, our Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, the one that we remember, our Savior Jesus, Lord, we offer you these holy gifts for the memorial of your Son. We remember his blessed passion, his precious death, his mighty resurrection, his glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. Christ has died,
Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again.
Lord, we ask that you would accept this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, asking that you grant by the merits and the death of your Son Jesus and by our faith in his blood, that we, your whole church, may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all the other benefits of his passion and love. Lord, I confess, that I have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed. What I have left undone.
I
have not loved my neighbor as myself.
Lord, for these things I am sorry.
I humbly repent.
For
the the sake of your Son, Jesus.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
Please have mercy upon me.
Please have mercy upon me.
That I may delight in your will.
That I may delight in your will.
Walk in your way.
Walk in your way.
Bring glory to your name.
Bring glory to your name.
All my days.
All my days.
Although we are unworthy, Lord, because of our many sins, to offer you any sacrifice at all, we ask that you accept this service that we owe, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, unite the church. Lord, unite the church. Lord, we got another election cycle coming. We got crazy on the horizon. Lord, unite the church. Lord, take us away from being political organizations. Lord, unite the church. Lord, may we help our communities, wherever our communities are. Lord, unite the church. Lord, the church is filled with people that desperately, desperately, not only need help, but they need empowered to go be the hands and the feet, the things that you have called us to do. Lord, unite the church. Unite the church with the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. understand, I could be the mama that said, okay, so don't trust me. If the Lord stirs hunger in you because of something that I said, don't take my word as the gospel. Go dig. Go read, go pray, go look up histories, go ask questions. I'm not on that board. Does that make sense? I'm sitting in the mirror with you as the hands and the feet of it. And so, I'm fallible. The only way I know how to lead is to take you to the places I'm going and hopefully stir hunger in you. But there may be places where we have to go, wait a minute, let's back up. And I'm man enough to admit, if I totally screwed something up, I'm going to tell you. So I can be mama in this, and I realize that. So dig, look, pray, read, okay? May God bless us with discomfort at the easy answers, the half-truths, and the superficial relationships of this world, so that we may live deep within our heart where the Holy Spirit dwells. May God bless us with anger at the injustice, the oppression, and the exploitation of people, so that we may work for, pray for justice, freedom, everlasting peace. May God bless us with tears for those that suffer pain, rejection, addiction, hunger, war, so that we may reach out our hands to comfort them, to turn their pain to joy. And may God bless us with enough foolishness to actually believe that we can sit at that table, that we can make a difference in this world, so that we can do what others claim cannot be done, to bring justice and kindness and love and joy and peace and Jesus to the world. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all and bring this to pass. Amen.
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 Would you stand with me, please?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Lord, I love you. Lord, thank you for taking the bouncing ping pong balls, Lord, I don't know. I thank you for taking my fears and my excitement and mixing it all up into something that actually makes a little bit of sense. Lord, thank you for breakfast. Thank you for the work my wife put in to get all of this ready. Lord, you're amazing and you're awesome. And all God's people said,
amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen.